Yep. I did. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Sunday in Advent, and Christmas Sunday. We have services tomorrow night here in the church at tomorrow afternoon at 5 o'clock, candle lighting service. As we wind down the Advent season and move into the end of Christmas, we recall that the first candle on our Advent wreath is the candle of light, reminding us that Jesus was the light of the world. The second reminds us of the prophets who predicted the coming of a Messiah to the people with a message of hope. The third candle reminds us that the Messiah was from both the royal line of David and of humble origins, and it's a brighter, as they like to say, more joyful color, from the lineage of David and yet from the family of the carpenter, which signifies that is coming, and the message that he brings is not just for a few, but for everyone, powerful and not powerful. And today we light the candle of righteousness, reminding ourselves that Jesus was the righteous one, the best one, who, though he didn't expect perfection from us, we can always breathe a sigh of relief on that one, because the odds of reaching perfection are pretty remote. But he did expect that we would follow him and come closer to being and doing what God loves. The bishop always asks at annual conference at the ordination of elders, will you strive for perfection? And people kind of chuckle. And he says, and one of the bishops said, wait a minute, I didn't say, are you expecting to be made perfect? Because if you are, we've got bigger problems. And he says, are you strive for it. And that's what Jesus would have us do. The season of preparation has drawn to an end, and the hour is at hand for the celebration of the birth of the Christ, which we do today and tomorrow and the next day. The lights grow brighter, the long-expected Messiah in spirit is among us and drawing us thus closer to God. Today our folder is a little different. We have announcements on the second page, fourth page actually, second sheet. And then we have prayer concerns on that same piece of paper, but it's several pages back. Prayer concerns over there, so that's where we'll turn if you want us for those. The announcements are pretty much self-explanatory, so we can move on, I think, by standing and taking a few moments to move about and greet one another for this time of worship.
Good.
Singing of this first hymn, I would think that this would be the time that our little troop of players would move into place or come up to the front and start getting ready for the Christmas program. I am remiss. Got up here this morning and forgot to say,
Merry Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas. I figured somebody would pick up on that. Okay, our first hymn is number 246, Joy to the World.
Thank you.
Christmas tree. Those are sacks of goodies, treats, and people who put those sacks together would very much like it if you could take one. Everybody take one after on your way out this morning after the worship service. So, our program.
Most people know the story of the friendly beasts and the legend that on the stroke of midnight on Christmas Eve, the animals can talk. It's the story that gives us the song, The Friendly Beasts. This is in your bulletin. Something new, something exciting, something tremendous. A Christmas story no one has ever heard before.
I know what's exciting. Math. We should do a Christmas story about numbers.
Woo! Yeah. Awesome. Could you narrate a story about the friendly numbers? Sort of like the friendly beasts. Talk about the old legend that at the stroke of midnight on Christmas Eve, the numbers have the gift of speech.
That's easy, April, because Bible numbers are always speaking to us. There's a Bible number game Jesus himself may have played when he grew up. It's called One Who Knows One. Here's how it goes. I say a number, and then whoever knows something about that number in the Bible should shout out what they know. So I say One Who Knows One, and then you say something that there is one of in the Bible. So...
say one God.
One God! Yay! Then you get a piece of candy. Do we have any other ones?
One Savior.
One Savior. Piece of candy. What's a Christmas play without music? We need a song to go with along with this game. Who knows a good song? The Forbidden Song, but it's forbidden.
Let's do it anyways.
Very nice. Now let's do two. Who knows two? There are two blank in the Bible.
Testaments,
exactly. A piece of candy for the man. Any other twos?
Oh, thank you.
What about three? This one's really easy.
Three kings.
Three kings, perfect. Go get a piece of candy.
Can I get a piece of candy?
Yeah. All right, now let's sing a three song, hymn 254, We Three Kings.
Thank you.
Gospels. Perfect.
I was going to say that.
What about five? Who knows five? Oh, we're getting up to the tough ones.
Five sheep.
Perfect. What about six? Who knows six? Okay. Seven. What about seven?
7 days of creation.
7 days of creation. That's a good one.
But I did six.
Give him another check. Somebody else wants seven.
Seven? Someone else say seven? Bible story. Do you have another seven?
Seven sheep.
Six days of creation
plus
7 days of rest.
Hey. Oh, you're right, I was wrong. I can't take this.
Alright, what about eight? Do we have eight?
Three. What did Jesus and his apostles do at the Last Supper?
They ate!
What about nine? This is the last one we got.
Nine angels!
Alright, and then 10. Who knows 10? What about there? 10 commandments. Yes, that's very good. Alright, then we sing Go Where I Send Thee.
Silence!
number.
Aha! David is both a name and a number. In Hebrew, it has three letters, Dalet, Vav, and Dalet. Dalet is 4, Vav is 6, and Dalet is 4. When you add them together, you get...
14.
Yeah, that sounds right. that's why Matthew divides Jesus' genealogy in 3 sets of 14 generations. He is saying, David, David, David. Now we can sing Royal David's Inn, which is hymn 250. Multitude. We'll sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing Like a Multitude of Soldiers, which is 240.
Slip into our thinking when we don't expect them, and when there are things of great joy, we should lift them up in thanksgiving. When there are things that threaten us or frighten us, or when there are people who bother us in unpleasant ways, we should lift them up in our prayers as well. Pray for understanding, and pray for peace and relationship. Loving God, whom an angel announced in Jesus, you came first to the lowly and the meek. Surprise us in our worship this day and in our lives every day. Christ not only in Christmas, but in all of our activities. Each day, wherever we are, however pleasant or unpleasant things are, all the year. And hear us as we continue in prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Our reading this morning is very familiar, the most familiar passage for most of us, I would guess. The Gospel of Luke, the second chapter. One of the few times in the year that I read out of the King James translation of Scripture. It's a beautiful story, and the language is beautiful. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. This taxing was first made when Sarvinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth and in Judea unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was, while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. She brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in an inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign to you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace, goodwill towards all. It came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph, and the babe lying in a manger. When they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. All they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they heard and seen as it was told unto them. One of the beauties of Scripture is its appeal to patterns in the human condition which just don't change very much from age to age. It's timeless. In the writings of the prophets, we find judgment and hope. Israel had an irritating habit of lapsing into complacency and self-righteousness and self-centeredness. The prophets judged that if those people continued that way, they'd regret it. And they did. And they did. They also said the Messiah would come and restore to them the land that God promised would be their homeland, and that therefore they could have hope, which they did. A A sense of place is important to human beings. It was true for people then, and it's true for people in our own time. We have a special relationship with our land, our farmsteads, our schools and towns. I have a thing about roads. You can drive along and I'll see where a road used to be 500 yards off one way or the other. And sometimes when you go across towards Pier and out in that area, it's so flat and so wet, and really flat, but it's rather barren. You can see where generations of roads have been. I don't know what it is. It's something about that land and what people have done, how they've traveled over it. Of course, my whole professional life has been traveling over roads, so maybe that's part of my thing. Joseph returned to his place, his ancestral home with Mary, and it was there that Jesus was born. I think one of the nicest songs of the season is "I'll Be Home for Christmas," and I didn't even realize where it had come from or how poignant it was. It always seemed like a kind of cozy thing to me when I was growing up, but it came out of the war, as Archie Bunker used to say, the big one, World War II, and troops gathered listening to someone saying, "I'll be home for Christmas, but only in my dreams." And there are people right now. Singing the same thing, feeling the same thing in various places around the world. What does it mean, really, to be home for Christmas? Well, it means being in a place that's significant in our life. It's a sense of being where we belong in heart and mind. I no longer can go home where I lived as a child. I can't go home to any of the three places I lived as a child. I don't even know who lives in them. I drive by them at all different times. It's kind of like looking at all the roads out there. Someone else lives there, and my people with whom I live there are not there. Matter of fact, most of them aren't at all anymore. So I hang things on the Christmas tree in our home, which have been there all those years. My folks got married in 1937, and they bought some Christmas decorations, and at this point, they are not beautiful at all. And they're glass, and they're from Germany, and I don't know how they've lasted this long. Except my mother was the only one who was allowed to handle them. And I got them. And I didn't let anybody handle them. I mean, Kathy can't, she's careful, but Jay never got his hands on them. Or his sister either. A friend once said the difference between being a believer and a non-believer at this season is that the non-believer celebrates Christmas only one day of the year. It's kind of a high, oh, here we go. What are we going to do tomorrow? And the believer celebrates Christmas all year. Comes close to what home means in Scripture. It's more than a particular place. It's memory. It's a way to live. Celebrate all year means to have the spirit of the Bethlehem baby grown to man all the year. I think one of the funniest things I ever heard is a story about this woman who was walking along, went by the church with her little boy, and again this year she stopped in and they looked at the crèche. And the little boy looked over there and he walked over And he says, well, what I want to know is, when is this girl kid ever going to grow up? He says, he was like that last year. He was like that a couple years ago. He's a baby. He's always a baby. To celebrate all the year means to have the spirit of Bethlehem babe grown to man all the year. If he hadn't been the man that he was, we wouldn't care about where he was born or when he was born or even if he was born. That spirit is one of love, acceptance, forgiveness, hope, and sacrifice. A home should be the foundation of values and beliefs of its members, children and adults. One of the nice things about Christmas is it reminds us of those things. It reminds us of those basic tenets of how much God cares about us. For the Christian, Christ's birth is the foundation upon which the home should be built. I've always loved Christmas. I'm sure that part of it's been inspired by the cultural stuff. Family traditions, the giving of gifts, weeks and weeks of preparation, traveling to Grandpa and Grandma Keenan's, watching Mother bake from recipes she carefully copied from the radio, the neighbor lady, WNAX Yankton. I practically knew her and that family of hers as well as anybody. From her warm kitchen to our warm kitchen. It was a beautiful time. My love for Christmas is fed by that and all kinds of neat things we used to do with our youth groups and our church groups. And I value those things and cherish them in my heart. The beautiful thing is I've discovered what was important in them is compatible with the faith into which I've grown up. They had at their very center right and loving relationships with other people. I mean, what else would drive us to pile into a van? I had a Volkswagen van. It was shaped like just a freezer for a reason. It never got warm in the wintertime. It had air conditioning. If you roll the windows down, you got air, and that was the condition you were in. Anyway, we'd pile into this icebox, and we'd travel around town and stop at houses and sing to people we'd never even seen before. That's neat. Right and loving relationships with others that we don't even really know. I mean, anybody can love people that are important to them or a part of their lives, but to really have a loving concern and feeling for people who can't do anything for you, who don't know you, who you'll probably never see again, that's critical. Discovered that within me I'd built a home in which Christmas could live, and not just in December, but all the year. I found a lot of happiness in that. And what a blessing it's been to me and mine. Of course, I push it a little bit. I keep our tree up until Kathy wonders if we have Valentine decorations we can put on it. I think last year it came down earlier than it has for a long time, so we're kind of getting caught up with it sometimes. It takes work, though, to maintain a home. Are we willing to make room in our lives all the year, make a home in our lives all the year for the spirit of Christmas? Or do we pack it away as quickly as we do the little decorations and things? The little boy and his mother went by the church and he asked, doesn't that kid ever grow up? I wonder what the mother said to him. See, the funny part of the story was the kid's question, but it never went anywhere after that. It was just a little cartoonish kind of a thing. Why does it seem so often that we haven't let him grow up in our thinking, influence our lives for more than just a few weeks in December? He isn't just good old plastic Jesus who gets conveniently stuck in a box for most of the year. A baby born in a manger that night so long ago grew to be a man who became our Lord, who, if he'll go on living in our midst, must have a home in our hearts, room within each of us. It's one of those things I think we, if somebody asked, we'd say, well, yeah, you know, I believe in these things, and I try to live a good life and all that. But I think we have to really go out of our way to make him room. A home for Christmas has to have room, has to be big enough for everybody. A star was sent to the wise men of the east, and an angel to shepherds on neighboring fields. Behold, I bring you glad tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Home is a place, a time, an attitude, but it's more than that. I'll be home for Christmas ends with, if only in my dreams. For centuries, Israel had dreamed of a home. Messiah came in the form of Jesus, but the broad view he had of life said that home was no longer limited to a particular place and a particular time, and surely not to the realm of dreams. It's much, much larger than that. In him, we can be home spiritually in the knowledge that God is indeed with us. We are not alone. And for that, we can say thanks be to God. God really cares what happens in our lives. And that life here on earth has meaning and doesn't end even when our time on earth ends. So, we were talking on the way into town today about it's how it seemed over the years our families have all gone different directions. And I was thinking, I had an uncle in California, I had one in Maine, and I hardly ever saw them. But I had an uncle in Watertown, I hardly ever saw them. In Sioux City, I rarely saw them. Went to a program one time and realized the speaker was a cousin of mine. And we talked briefly, but we didn't really seem to know each other. Well, we didn't know each other. So what do you do when you are going to go home for Christmas? What is home? You have to sort that one out. I mean, who am I to figure it out for anyone else? I know what I try to do. I know what it is to me. I know what it feels like. So I say, whether you're going home, or coming home, or staying home for Christmas, make an effort that it might be more than time with family and friends. Make it a time of recommitment to God and Christ, a commitment which will serve to influence values and life where you live out your time, whether it's in Aberdeen, or Warner, or Britain, or Watertown. Wherever it is, or the sophisticated boroughs of greater New York. Wherever it is you live out your time, make it a part, make your life a part of the body of Christ, which is the church here in this place this day, or any place, any day, scattered throughout the weeks ahead. We had a fire in our church in Fargo, happened to be Faith United Methodist Church, 2 days after Christmas. And it was a lot of fun for the media because one of them came up and wondered if they could interview me, so we sat in the office, the only building room in the whole building that wasn't smoke damaged. And this reporter said, do you ever wonder why God would let your church burn? I said, not really. I said, why wouldn't God let our church burn? I mean, what makes us, what makes this place any more significant, really, than someone's house, or someone's business, or a church down the road that's so different from us, we wonder if we're even in the same faith. why shouldn't it happen to us? Well, that wasn't what the person was hoping to hear, so it was a relatively short interview, but that was all right. I had enough to do. But the idea is that the church isn't just a place. Home isn't just a particular location or a particular house or a particular town. For some, it always is, but for most, it isn't. It's in our heart. It's how we relate wherever we go. And it doesn't depend on this building, or the one in Fargo, or the little ones we drive by, some of which are closed, and some of which have become homes for people, or whatever. But it depends on who we are and whose we are, and how we relate to the others of God's children. Wherever we are. One of the upsides of our fire in Fargo was, I'll talk about that some other time. They had this way of not ever doing any maintenance. It was a fairly new building. The wiring was bad. All kinds of stuff should have been done, but they deferred maintenance. And somebody asked how we felt about the fire, and I said, well, I wouldn't say this around a group of insurance people. That's the best thing that ever happened to us. We got $600,000 worth of upgrading, only for a few hundred dollars a month, year-round, for a few years. Matter of fact, we raised a full coverage in October. In December, we collected. The downside of that was those people didn't learn how to maintain their building anyway, because they waited till the end and they got it taken care of. Maybe God does look after people like that. Probably does. Let's pray. Eternal God, we enjoy this season in the church, the carols and hymns that remind us of the good purpose you work among your people, your global family. We pray that our celebration in the church and in all we do in our hurried and harried preparations will ultimately draw attention to you, what you did for and among your people in the man Jesus. You show that we people can follow in his steps and help others to know you and your love and your promise for these days and for eternity. We pray for those who have not heard the good news and those who have heard but don't believe it. Those who walk in darkness and the shadow of death, and for your church that will help all those it touches to find their way, your way. In Jesus' name we've gathered, and in his name we pray. Amen. We are a people who are richly blessed. It's fitting that we share some of our material blessings for the work of the church, not only here in Aberdeen, but throughout the world, which we'll do at this time by receiving our morning offering. Thank you. Help us to use them wisely, to share them generously, wherever our life as your people takes us. Amen. Our hymn is number 251, Go Tell It on Mom.
Thank you. the show's over.
Yeah.
What is it?
I'm not sure.
Maybe that baby Jesus.